Welcome and thank you for checking out our service. Make sure to visit our website, sardiniacc.com, or download our church app to stay up to date and connected with everything going on here at SCC. And no matter where you're tuning in from today, we hope that this message encourages you and challenges you to follow Jesus and make disciples. God bless, and we hope to see you soon at one of our live in-person worship gatherings on Sunday morning at 10 a.m. About 4 years ago, my Atlanta Falcons were playing in the Super Bowl. And going into the fourth quarter, they had the lead. They were up by like four scores. And if you know anything about that Super Bowl, you know it was the greatest comeback in history for the other team. You know, a few days before Jesus was crucified, he rode into town. Everybody was singing his praises. They were saying, "Hosanna, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." And his disciples were feeling a lot like I did the first three quarters of that Super Bowl. They were riding high. They were excited. They were about to be crowned victors. But then Thursday night came, and Jesus was arrested, and he was tried, and he was sentenced, and he was beaten and tortured and killed. And for them, it was game over. They couldn't believe it. Their king had been killed. And they thought that was the end of it. They thought there wasn't going to be an overtime. But then on Sunday morning, Jesus proved them all wrong. And he came back to life. The greatest comeback ever. And that's what we celebrate every single week when we take communion. We celebrate that comeback. That God did what he said he was going to do. And you know, we sometimes feel so defeated in life because of sin, because of the effects that sin has over us. Man, but Jesus is inviting us to be a part of that comeback because of what he did on the cross and because of his resurrection. We can have victory. We can have hope for a future. And so in just a moment, after we pray, we're just going to ask you to take just a moment to reflect on that, to reflect on what Christ has done for us, the victory that he had over the grave. And then after that, when you're ready, you can go to one of the communion stations we have around the room. If you're at home, watching from home, you can pause and take communion with your family. But let's go to our Heavenly Father right now and thank him for what Jesus did for us. Lord, we are so grateful. God, when we had counted it out, when we didn't think there was any hope, Jesus did the impossible. He came back to life. He proved that he had victory over the grave. He has victory over death. He has victory over sin. God, and because he conquered sin and because he paid that price for us, we have the hope of celebrating for eternity with you. And so, God, we remember that this morning. We thank you for that this morning as we take this bread and we take this cup and we remember what they represent. They represent what Jesus endured for us on the cross. We pray all this in his name. Amen. Good morning. Again, welcome to Sardinia Church of Christ. Thank you for being here. Thank you for joining us. If you're watching from online today, it is indeed a super Sunday. We got our small groups kicking back off this week. I want to encourage you to sign up for one of those. You will be glad that you did. If you're watching at home and you're not able to come back yet in person, you can sign up for an online group for everybody. We also put all of our small group discussion guides online through our mobile app. So even if you can't make it here, even if you can't make it a small group, you can still go through those at home with your family. So we hope you will take advantage of that. But we are excited. Our kids are back today. Our children's ministry is back in action in full swing. We've got our students, our high school and junior high students in our student ministry service today. And so we are super, super, super excited for that as well. We are also continuing our Money Talks series. We've been having these little talks for the past few weeks about what God's Word says about money. And in particular, how we can handle money in such a way that our hearts reflect that of our Heavenly Father. We want to approach finances and money in such a way that we cultivate the same generous, loving, compassionate, grace-filled heart that our God has toward us. And so we've been looking in depth at His Word and how it instructs us to use the money that God has blessed us with. The first week, we talked about honoring God with our first fruits. He instructed us to do that because that demonstrates that God has first place in our life, that we trust Him to provide for what we need and not our money. Last week, we looked at a parable that Jesus told about a master who entrusted three of his servants with large sums of money. It's called the parable of the talents. It can also be translated as the parables of the bags of gold. And that master, he went on a long journey and he gave one of his servants five bags of gold, one of his servants two bags of gold, another one bag of gold. When he came back, he found that the first two of his servants had wisely put that money to work. They had managed it according to his expectations. They managed it so well that they had doubled the amount of money that they were given. They were stewards because they knew that that money belonged to their master. They knew what he expected, so they treated and managed that money accordingly. But that third servant, what did he do? He went and hid that money, didn't he? He hid his master's money. He allowed the fear of losing money to control his actions. He allowed his money to master him. So, of course, when the master saw that he had wasted all that he was given, his master was pretty upset. Now, to help you all soak in the lesson that we learned through this parable last week, we did a little unconventional object lesson. Many of you who were here last week left with $5 of someone else's money. Mine. You left with my money, right? And the objective, your mission, was to carry that $5 around with you all week long so that you felt the responsibility of caring for something that belonged to someone else that they had entrusted to you. Now, I gave you $5 because I believe all of you are five baggers, like from this story, okay? I believe you are worthy of my trust. I believe that you are responsible. I believe that you cared for that money as if it was not yours because it was not yours. All right, and today we get to see if I rightfully trusted you or if I misplaced my trust because you were asked to bring that $5 back. Now, several of you, when you left last week, you had the audacity before you walked out of this building to say, "Hey, Brett, thanks for lunch." Okay? Now, hopefully, the Holy Spirit convicted you of your sinful thoughts this week, and you actually brought that back. But there is a special collection box that's right out these doors, right out the doors of this room, where if you haven't already, you can return what was entrusted to you because I need that money back. Okay? It came out of my emergency fund, and if I don't get it back, there's going to be an emergency. Now, the truth I wanted all of us to take away last week, though, is that our money is not ours. It doesn't belong to us. It's God's money, and He's called us to be stewards, not spenders, of His money. Stewards use money according to the way their master has instructed them to. Spenders see money as something for their own benefit. They believe their money belongs to them. Stewards apply God's word to how they handle their money and finances. And by doing so, they not only do they become more like their master, become more like their heavenly father, but also they experience the blessings. Remember in last week's parable, the master said, hey, come and share in your master's happiness. They were invited to enjoy the blessings that belong to their master. Spenders, on the other hand, they opt to keep God out of their finances, and by doing so, they fail to enjoy any of the blessings, but they also ensure that their spiritual muscles will remain lethargic and weak. Now, the truth that we're going to look at today is that we've all been called not only to exercise our faith through generosity, but that giving is a spiritual gift that we have been called to grow, to get better at, to exercise. And so we're going to be looking at the Apostle Paul's letter to the church in Corinth. And so we're going to look at the book of 2 Corinthians, if you have your Bibles with you today. It's located about halfway through your New Testament. Now, to set it up, here's some background on this church that Paul is writing to. The church in Corinth, the Corinthian church, had all sorts of problems. In Paul's first letter, the book of 1 Corinthians, he addresses a lot of their problems. There was division and disunity in the church. There was a bunch of arguing. There was just some arrogant people. They had some sexual immorality going on, a bunch of other sin. They were simply a mess. And so he wrote them to whip them into shape, to get them to quit acting like children and start maturing in their faith. Well, now when we get to 2 Corinthians, some time has passed. They started to get a little bit better in some areas. They were still lagging, though, in a few aspects of their maturity. One that especially came to Paul's mind was their lack of maturity when it came to being generous with what God had given them. Now, Corinth, the city of Corinth in the ancient world, it was a center of trade, a center of commerce for the entire Mediterranean world. Traders could get there by land or sea. It served as a connection point for Greece and the rest of the Roman Empire. Corinth was a very affluent and wealthy city. They had the latest and greatest, the state of art of everything. There was a large athletic arena that held thousands and thousands of people. Every 2 years in Corinth, they held some Olympic-style games. People came from all over the Roman Empire to attend. The Corinthian people loved competition, some competitiveness, and so this spilled over into other aspects of their life. Even when it came to their finances, when it came to earning and accumulating wealth. And so it should come as no surprise that the people who were in the Corinthian church, they were fairly well off when it came to their finances. In fact, for those days and those standards, they were actually pretty rich. The problem is their faith hadn't caught up to their finances yet. And when it came to generosity, they were actually pretty weak. And the reason they were weak is because of this truth right here. The more you get, the harder it is to give. The more you get, the harder it is to give away. Now, you think it would be the opposite, right? You think that the more you have, the more your needs are met, then the easier it'd be to be willing to let go of the excess. But that's not how our human nature works. That's not how the nature that's been tainted by sin works. Actually, for the most part, the opposite is true. The opposite is that the more we get, the more we want. Listen to these words from the richest man who ever walked the earth, King Solomon. He's also the wisest man, too. This is his words when he's old in life and he's looking back. And he says, whoever loves money never has enough. Whoever loves wealth is never satisfied with their income. You know, several years ago, Newsweek did an article about the relationship between money and happiness. And what they found was that, interestingly enough, people who made $5 million a year were virtually no happier than people who made 50 times less than they did, and someone who only made $100,000. Another study showed that when asked how much is enough money to make you happy, how much money is enough, almost everyone surveyed answered with an amount that was almost twice of what they currently made. It was almost double of what they had. Think about it, though. I mean, when your income goes up, when you receive that raise at work, when you have some extra money come in, what's the first thing that we typically do? See, usually when our income increases, we want to increase our lifestyles, right? We think about how we can be more comfortable. That bigger house, the nicer car, maybe the RV, the boat, those season tickets. I mean, that's typically where our minds go when we see our paycheck getting bigger. They don't always go straight to giving it away. Even if we're faithful tithers, even if we are already in the habit of giving, wealth has a way of tempting us to forget about generosity. You know, if you make about $35,000 a year, then your tithe is roughly $67 a week. $67, okay, that's not terrible. But if you make $85,000 a year, your tithe is now $163 a week, which is over $650 a month. That's a lot of money, right? Now we're talking, maybe we're getting into a second or third vacation kind of money right now, maybe a luxury car payment. You see what you're up against the more money that you make. Now, if you were to give that away, I mean, that giving can really start to add up. And you start to see what you could have done with the money had you kept it for yourself. And this is the dilemma that Paul is running into with the Corinthian church. And so he writes to address this in chapter 8 of 2 Corinthians. He's been talking to them now about how they ought to be maturing in their faith, and he shifts the conversation to how they ought to be maturing in their giving. Verse 1, he says, "And now, brothers and sisters, we want you to know about the grace that God has given to the Macedonian churches. In the midst of a very severe trial, their overflowing joy and their extreme poverty welled up in rich generosity." So Paul starts off this section of his letter by relaying what other churches had been able to do in terms of their giving, their generosity. You see, the Corinthians, we said, they liked a good challenge, right? They liked that competitive spirit. Competition drove them to get better in all facets of their lives. And so it's almost as if Paul is using that. He's saying, "Hey guys, hey, let me tell you about what this other church did. Let me tell you what these other churches have accomplished." But his comments here make it especially intriguing to his audience. He says that these other churches were giving in the middle of a severe trial, that they were generous even in circumstances of extreme poverty. Now, the cities where Paul is referring to in Macedonia, these weren't necessarily like the poor parts of town. The economy was strong in cities like Philippi and Thessalonica. However, nothing could stop the hostile persecution that these churches were experiencing. These believers were facing extreme persecution. In fact, it's most likely that their poverty came as a direct result of being harassed and persecuted. People quit doing business with the Macedonian Christians. They tried to harm them both physically and financially as a way to eradicate all of those who proclaimed faith in Christ. And this wasn't a soft blow. That phrase that Paul uses, extreme poverty, it carries with this connotation that they were at rock bottom. They were bankrupt. Faith in Jesus had left them with little to nothing. Notice what Paul says next. He says, "For I testify that they gave as much as they were able and even beyond their ability. Entirely on their own, they urgently pleaded with us for the privilege." Everybody say privilege. privilege of sharing in this service to the Lord's people. So Paul says they were able to give beyond what they could, beyond their ability. Now, I know that many of you here today, 2020 was a rough year. 2020 hit you pretty hard. In fact, it's probably what you would call a severe trial. The pandemic, the political climate, it's emptied you, and maybe not just emptied you financially, but maybe emotionally, mentally, maybe even spiritually. You feel like you have nothing left to give. And for these churches that Paul is writing to, they're in the same boat. The persecution had ravaged the church to the point where they really had nothing left. How could someone ask them to give when there wasn't even enough to take care of themselves? And yet it says they considered it a privilege to share in the giving. They pled to be able to share in the generosity, and they trusted that God would provide and provide in abundance. Why were they able to do this? Why did they want to share in that privilege? Well, it's because it produced in them the joy that comes from having faith in the one to whom everything belongs. And so how were they able to give beyond their means, beyond their ability? Well, the answer is they weren't. But God was. You see, God did it. God is the one who enabled them to give more than they ever could have imagined. And by God's grace and through their willingness and eagerness to share in that privilege, he took what little that they had and he multiplied it. Look at how Paul brags in verse 5. He says, they exceeded our expectations. They gave themselves first of all to the Lord, and then by the will of God also to us. And so we urged Titus, just as he had earlier made a beginning, to bring also to completion this act of grace on your part. Paul says, look, if they can do it, if these Macedonian churches living in extreme poverty can do it, then you can too. Because at the end of the day, it's not you that allows you to give more than you can. It's God. God does that. It's the Lord. When you feel like there's no way you can give as much as you do and still survive, God says, watch me. When you think there's no way you can give toward the Lord's work and still pay the bills, 2 Corinthians reminds us that you can't, but God can. When you think it's impossible to give above and beyond what you already are, when you think there's no way you can be more generous than you have been, God is chomping at the bit to show you what he can do through his grace. And that's why the last thing Paul says in this verse here is, your part. You see, you have a part to play. God allows us this gift and this ability to give, but it's our part to trust him and actually follow through in obedience. Follow through and actually give. That's Paul's challenge to us. It was his challenge to the Corinthian church. Look at verse 7. He says, but since you excel, right, there's that competitive spirit coming out. Since you excel in everything, in faith and speech and knowledge and complete earnestness and in the love we've kindled in you, see that you also excel in this grace of giving. You see, the ability to give is a gift that we are supposed to grow. Giving, generosity, is a gift we are supposed to grow. God gives us the ability to give generously, and it's a gift we're called to get better at. We all have things we want to get better at. Right? You want to be a better parent. You want to refine your skills at your job or as employees, as leaders. We want to get better at our marriage, at our sport, at our trade. We want to grow in these arenas of our life. For Jesus followers, we want to get better at the things that Jesus has called us to as well. We want to get better at being patient and kind and joyful. We want to grow in our ability to discern God's word and apply his truth to our lives. We want to get better at praying, at serving others. And Paul says with generosity, it's no different. We ought to be better at giving the longer we are in Christ. It's something that we ought to be getting better at. But to do so takes practice, takes commitment, right? Just like with athletes, we're going to watch later tonight in the big game, just like the athletes that the Corinthians used to watch at the Olympic-style games, takes commitment, takes practice. It's something you have to do over and over and over to get better at. At the height of his career, Michael Jordan was, well, he was the top-earning athlete in the world. He was the highest-paid athlete on the planet. He had already won 3 NBA championships by the early 90s, and he could have easily just coasted out the rest of his career, and yet he didn't. Instead, he pushed himself to get better. Anybody remember the movie Space Jam? Yeah? Oh, yeah, that's my jam. You know what I'm talking about? Yes. So Jordan spent several months filming this movie in the mid-90s during the NBA offseason, but instead of taking it easy while filming the movie, he still found time amidst a 12-hour schedule every day. He still found time to practice basketball for 5 hours a day, also including a 2-hour training session during his breaks on the movie set. Why did he do this? Because he wanted to get better at it. When nobody else thought anyone could be any better, he got better. By the way, he went on to win 3 more championships, consecutive championships after this. Back to our text. I could talk about sports all day. Chapter 8, verse 8. This is what Paul tells him. He says, look, I'm not commanding you, but I want to test the sincerity of your love by comparing it with the earnestness of others. Paul says, look, this isn't a command straight from Jesus. I didn't get it from him, but I'm doing this to test you. Remember, they love competition. They love that challenge. He says, look, I'm testing you, and the test is to see if your giving matches where your heart is. After all, what you do with your money reveals the condition of your heart. Where your treasure is, there your heart will also be. That did come from Jesus. What you value shows up in where you put your money. And so Paul is asking them not just to compare the size of their offering to the Macedonian churches, but also, more importantly, to compare the attitudes of their hearts. Are they really excelling? Are they really growing? Are they really getting better at the things that matter? And then he says this in verse 9. He says, for you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sake became poor, so that through you, through his poverty, might become rich. Paul says, look, don't compare yourself to others. Don't compare yourself to other people, other churches, what other people are doing. The standard was set by who? By Jesus. Christ is the one who gave up the riches of heaven, the glory of being with the Father. Jesus is the one who emptied himself, emptied his heavenly bank account. And he gave all that he had so that you could experience true riches, so that you could experience the blessings of being in a right relationship with your heavenly Father. It's as if Paul is saying, look, whether or not you embrace generous and sacrificial giving demonstrates whether or not you grasp a full understanding of who Jesus is. Think on that one for a minute. Go ahead and jump over to chapter 9. Paul's going to sum up what he's talking about with giving in this section. In verse 6, Paul's going to tell him this. He says, remember this, whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and whoever sows generously will also reap generously. Each of you should give what you have decided in your heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion. Everybody read that last part with me? For God loves a what? Cheerful giver. Now, this principle of sowing and reaping, you farmers know this all too well. The more seed you scatter, the better chance for a bigger, greater harvest. I heard about a guy who came to his pastor with a problem one time. He said, Pastor, look, I know what the Bible says about giving. I know I'm supposed to be giving to the Lord. I know I'm supposed to be generous with what I have, but I just can't bring myself to do it. Look, I know I'm supposed to, but the Lord has blessed me. My business has grown so much over the last couple of years. Do you know that it's to the point now where if I were to tithe, I'd be giving almost $4,000 a month to the church. I'd be giving away $4,000 a month. That's a lot of money, and I just don't know what to do. Pastor said, hey, no problem, brother. I got you. I think I can help. Let me just pray for you for a second. Lord, would you please decrease the size of this man's business and his income to the point where he feels comfortable giving? And the guy said, no, please don't pray that prayer. Please don't pray that prayer. You see, Paul says, you must decide. In your heart, you must decide. Give cheerfully or don't give at all. Give cheerfully from your heart or don't give. God doesn't want you to give begrudgingly or out of obligation. He doesn't want you to give because you feel like you have been forced or coerced. He's looking for people who want to give. He's looking for people who see it as the Macedonian churches did, as a privilege to partner in what God is doing in the world, who find joy in watching God take the seed out of generosity and then do amazing things with it. Look at verse 8. Paul says, and God is able to bless you abundantly so that, everybody say so that in all things, at all times, having all that you need, you will abound in every good work. Jump to verse 10. He says, now he who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will also supply and increase your store of seed and will enlarge the harvest of your righteousness. You will be enriched in every way so that, say that again, so that you can be generous on every occasion, and through us, your generosity will result in thanksgiving to God. You know, the majority of people in this world, they want a couple things in life. They want to experience being part of something that's bigger than themselves, and they want their life to matter beyond this lifetime. And friends, when we decide in our hearts to give generously and cheerfully, we can experience those things. Because the promise here is that God chooses to bless generous people so that we can abound in good works. He enriches us so that we continue to be a blessing to more and more people, so that we can continue to be more and more generous. And so the question is, are your hands open or are they closed? Are you freely giving what God is blessing you with? Are you giving what you are receiving, or are you holding on tight to the illusion that it's my money? I earned it. I get to decide what I do with it. God's going to continue to bless those who prove to be generous and fruitful with what he's given them. It says he will enlarge your harvest. That means that as you give cheerfully, as you grow in that gift of giving, as you get better at it, you will have a greater impact for God's kingdom. You'll see more and more needs met, more people engaged with the gospel, more souls saved from sin, more marriages reconciled, more people freed from addiction, more and more kids growing up in a Christ-centered home with both parents who love them. God will exponentially increase the seed of giving that you sow in your life, and then you're going to be able to watch the incredible harvest that he produces. Now, I know this is a lot easier said than done. I know the pressure of providing for a family, the weight of trying to make ends meet, the feeling when there's more month left than money. I've also experienced the temptation to increase my lifestyle before increasing my giving whenever I receive more money. But so that you don't think I'm not practicing what I preach, I want to give you just a couple examples here of how Brittany and I are striving to grow in our giving, to get better at generosity. And the first thing I shared with you guys a couple of weeks ago that we decided early on in our marriage that anything that we receive, any income that comes in, we tithe off of that income. Now, we saw also a couple weeks ago, tithing shows up in the Old Testament. It kind of serves as that standard or that base who want to honor the Lord with their first fruits. But the passage we read today says that we should give what we have decided in our hearts to give. You see, we're not obligated to give 10% of our incomes as Christ followers. It's not like that if we don't give 10%, he's not going to let us into heaven. However, as followers of Jesus, we've been called to give him everything that we have, to put everything under his lordship, to bring everything that we have into submission to him. And so to us, 10% seemed like a great place to start out when it came to giving, but it was a lousy place to finish. Plus, you know, in the Old Testament, when you counted all their tithes and all the offerings that they were required to give through the law, it actually came out to somewhere between 25 to 30% of the Israelites' income. And so we said, wow, well, we've got a long way to catch up just to get to what the Old Testament people were required to give. And so because of this, Brittany and I budget every single year not only to increase the amount of our tithe as our income goes up, but we also budget to increase the percentage. Another way we strive to grow in our giving is through offerings. Offerings being something that's extra on top of what we already tithe. And so we support several different ministries through some offerings. I have a friend I went to high school with. His name is Jonathan Irby. And Jonathan, he's the guy in the middle of that picture right there. Jonathan is the director of Athletes in Action, which is a campus ministry. They minister to student athletes, and he's at the University of Georgia chapter. Go Dawgs. Athletes in Action is in campuses and universities all around the world, and they seek to disciple student athletes so that they can have a great impact for Christ all across the college scene. Now, Jonathan didn't always want to go into campus ministry. In fact, he once told me when we were students in college that his goal was to make as much money as he could when he graduated. Somewhere along the way in his college journey, God got a hold of him. He threw Jonathan a curveball. He became involved in this campus ministry. He felt God tugging at his heart to give up his plans and to go into full-time campus ministry. Now, in most campus ministries on college campuses, anyone who works in those nonprofit organizations, they have to raise almost 100% of their support, of their salary. And so for about the last 11 years, Brittany and I have been able to financially support Jonathan so that he can continue to lead and train and disciple student athletes. And so many students have come to Christ through this ministry. This past year, Brittany and I were actually able to start supporting another friend who began working with a campus ministry at the University of Tennessee. In 2015, after receiving an increase in income, we felt led to begin sponsoring a child through Compassion International. Now, this little girl right here, her name is Paola. She's from El Salvador. She was born the day that Brittany and I got married. And so for almost the last 6 years, we've been able to partner in providing her with food and education, health care, a way for her to learn more about Christ through her local church. El Salvador was hit hard by a hurricane last year in 2020, but throughout all of this, Paola and hundreds of other Compassion kids in that country have been able to continue receiving support and hope for a future. We keep her picture on our fridge. Our family prays for her when we see that picture from time to time. We'll write letters back and forth with her. It is a blessing to see the kingdom impact that God is having thousands of miles away because we decided in our hearts to push ourselves to grow in our giving. And when you add up all of our tithes and offerings, the commitments, they currently come out to about 16% of our total income. And we continue to push ourselves in that, hoping that God will continue to bless us so that we can bless more and more people, support more and more ministries, see more and more lives changed because of God's faithfulness. My dream is that one day I will live old enough, God will bless me to a point where I can be like Zacchaeus, who said to Jesus, "Look, Jesus, from now on, I'm going to give away half of everything I have. Everything that comes in, I'm going to give away half of that." Man, I would love to be at that point, to be that strong in generosity. Now, I tell you all this not to toot Brett's horn, but I want to let you know that it can be done. That God is faithful, and when we exercise this gift of giving, God is able to grow that to a point where he can do things through you that you never thought could happen. Now, some of you in here are way better at giving, at generosity than I am. We need you. We need to learn from you. We need to hear your story of how God has blessed your efforts and generosity, how you have strived to be as generous as the Lord Jesus is. Church, when we choose to handle our money according to God's word, according to how we see it in his word, together we can be as generous as the Lord Jesus. Together we can and we ought to be encouraging one another to show the grace of Christ to the world through our generous spirits, through our open-handedness, with what God has given us. Let's pray. God, we know that every good gift comes from you. Everything we have, this whole world, every person who lives in it, they all belong to you. God, forgive us when we have the attitude that it's mine. Forgive us when we keep our hands close and cling tight to what we think is ours. But God, if you will, through your Spirit, enable us to open our hands, and as we receive, to pass it on, knowing that you're going to take care of us, you're going to provide for us, but you're also going to use what we give to grow your kingdom, to change hearts, to reconcile people to you. God, and you're going to do all that in abundance if we would just trust you. So God, today I pray that as a church, we would make a commitment right now that we are going to get better in the grace of giving. That we are going to grow in our generosity. God, we're so thankful that you are a generous God and you gave up the most precious thing you had. You gave up your son for us. God, I pray if there's someone in here today who hasn't experienced the grace that comes through Jesus, the one who suffered and died in their place, Father, that they would call on your name, they would surrender to Christ, that they would put that old life to death in baptism, that they would be raised to a new life. But God, we got to decide that in our hearts. We got to decide who's Lord, who's boss, who's in charge, who does everything belong to. Help us to do that today, Father. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, as we stand and worship, just want to invite you, if you need prayer this morning, we have a team of folks in the back who would love to pray, to go to God on your behalf. If you'd like to learn more about what it means to follow Jesus, not just with your money, but with your whole life, We'll gladly meet you down front here. We can set up the time to talk later this week. If you're watching online, please reach out to us. We want to have that conversation with you. Let's worship our Heavenly Father.